A forbidden story of a bedridden lady and two nurses, all with the same name, still keep the guests of Hotel Emma awake. Many old hotels tend to have an eerie kind of feeling associated with them. Even after several renovations, these strange vibes won't leave the place. While most of the people are scared of staying in such places, some are eager enough to pay a higher amount for staying. Hotel Emma is not the type of place you've seen in American Horror Story Hotel, but guests have reportedly felt the presence of someone other than humans at midnight. According to the company's official website, Hotel Emma is a delectably unique 146-room hotel with 7 top-floor suites, a handsome bar and club room, an excellent restaurant, a purveyor of fine foods, and public spaces reminiscent of fine old hotels in far-flung locales. While the huge hotel people see today started back in the early 18th century as a brew house, yes, you read it correct. This story took place in the historic Alamo Country, in the bustling Pearl District of San Antonio, Texas. Decades before the USA faced the Prohibition, this district witnessed one of the 19th century's most weird cases, the case of Otto Kohler, a story of love and betrayal, wealth and destruction, conspiracy and manipulation. In 1884, Otto Kohler observed the fortune present in the American brewing industry during those days. He knew nothing of this industry, but he was ready to take the risk. This one step brought him all the way to Missouri, Texas from Berlin, Germany. So far, he didn't know what the new lands had to offer, but he started with the first option he got to survive, unaware that soon his name will be etched in the history of Texas. Otto Kohler settled in St. Louis, Missouri, and started to look for options to flourish in America. After several months of interviews and research, Otto finally got an offer to join the Lone Star Brewery as a manager. The company was one of the first large mechanized breweries in the state. This proved to be his first step toward the ladder of success and wealth. Financially, Otto's life was a struggle, and romantically, it was much worse until he met the woman he loved and who loved him deeply. Her name was Emma Benson, a German native who trusted Otto with her life. When he offered her to start a new life with him in America, she agreed right away and came to the new country with her man. Sadly, this couple wouldn't withstand the test of time. German couple moved to Texas in 1884 to look for better earning options for themselves. And from there on, he learned everything about the brewing industry. As a result, enormous doors of opportunities opened in front of him. A couple of avenues gave him better offers, but he worked at Lone Star until he was an expert. While Otto was busy making contacts and learn every bits and piece of the business, Emma made sure she stood by his side through thick and thin. Just like she cleared the test, Otto would never be able to do the same for his wife. She was nothing but the first woman named Emma to have an impact on his life. Yes, there were two more to arrive soon before the destruction took place. Otto chose to work as the president of the Pearl Brewing Company in San Antonio, Texas. He moved to the new city immediately and started working. His vision was to take Pearl and his own career to new heights. Pearl soon evolved as one of the greatest breweries in the country. Soon Otto too was going to emerge as one of the richest men in the country. Alongside the Pearl Brewery, Otto too was becoming a known personality in the elite club. When it came to the brewing business, his skills and expertise were incomparable. His interest in the industry and his strong will to earn more brought him not only riches but also fame. And soon he was about to climb the highest step of success. The brewing industry needed a leader just like him, and that's when he was given the greatest designation there was in the business. Otto Kohler, an immigrant, was elected as the president of the Brewing Association. And with this new achievement added to his profile, Otto was known by every person associated with the brewing business. By this point of time, Otto was living the best days of his life. He was one of the richest men in the Southwest United States. He was now a respectful figure and a wealthy man with an abundance of wealth. But the shadows of the dark plot twist were still far from covering his limelight. Now that the first phase of this story, i.e., success and wealth, was already in the picture, the second phase of tragedy struck. Emma not only supported her husband by giving all her love to him, but also by helping him in his professional life. She too had a keen interest in the industry and always came up with great ideas to earn better profits than ever before. Obviously, the credit of it all went to the man, and none got to know the real one behind all those strategies. Before anything could even start to change, one devastating incident turned everything into a different direction. In 1910, while she was on her way home, Emma met with a serious car accident. After extended operations and several broken bones, Mrs. Kohler was kept under observation for over half a year. With no improvement and almost no hopes of improvement, Emma returned home with her husband only to find herself bedridden for the rest of her life. She lost her ability to do everything by herself. Emma was in need of a full-time caretaker. Obviously, her husband wasn't capable of providing her the much-needed care. Hence, he started to look for a nurse with good background and generous attitude. The search for the right nurse took him back to his native country, Germany. That's where he met another Emma. According to Otto, the best suitable nurse for his wife was another native of Germany, Emma Dunk, also known by her nickname Emmy. She had a couple of years of experience in full-time nursing. At least she looked like the right choice at that time. Emma, the nurse, was an attractive woman in her early 20s. She moved all the way from Germany to America as the rich man Otto offered a good amount of money in return for her work. She badly needed the money. At last, her actions soon made her a dumb name in the history of Texas. So, this nurse was there to look after Mrs. Kohler, but Otto could neither ignore her beauty nor control his emotions. The heavy load of loneliness was too much for the man to take. The nurse too gave him the signs of approval instead of resisting. This led their story towards the third phase, i.e., betrayal. It was just a matter of months as their minimal exchanges turned into a full-fledged adulterous relationship. It gave Emmy exactly what she needed, security and much higher income with a lavish lifestyle. On the other hand, Otto had one more surprise for the young lady. Otto, who was in the mid-50s, took Emma, the nurse, to huge parties and started to admit his relationship with his bedridden wife's nurse publicly. Although this worried the young nurse about her reputation, she never revealed her views in front of Otto. At this time, Emma felt the need of sharing the thoughts with someone, and that's where another girl walked in the scene. Now that Emmy was officially Otto's mistress, her distress made it hard for her to breathe. She called a friend of hers. Yes, this was how the third Emma entered their lives. Back in Germany, Emma had a Burgermeister and Emmy were co-workers. Talking to made Emmy realize how badly she needed someone to listen to her. So, Emmy came up with a bright idea. Emma had a Burgermeister who used to go by her middle name. Hedda was offered to join Emmy in America. Hedda was in her 30s and older than Emmy. Therefore, she had much more work experience. Otto hired her as a second nurse for his wife, and she too started to live in the Kohler mansion. Just like Emmy, Hedda too was described as a beauty by the world. For Otto, two sounded better than one, and Hedda didn't seem to have any issue with his intentions. As compared to Emmy, Hedda's income was much lesser, and it was clear that Emmy was Otto's favorite. Otto purchased a brand new cottage for the two ladies right in the heart of the city. He took them out for shopping and dinners. At times, he took them to the casino to test his luck. Spending money on them made the old man happy. They were not working as nurses anymore, but were still getting paid. Otto gave Emmy $125 as pocket money, while Hedda received a sum of $50 each month. As he wasn't looking after his ill wife anymore, all his money was being spent on the other two Emmas in his life. Unfortunately, what looked like a happy, lustful story till now was going to convert into a conspiracy. Otto was informed of Emmy's affair many times, but he didn't have any proofs. Just in case Emmy runs away, Otto transferred the cottage to Hedda's name. Sadly, this trick wasn't going to stop Emmy from eloping. In 1913, Otto's suspicions proved to be correct. Emmy was in love with Mr. Doschel, an American. It was too late by the time Otto even got a whiff of it. Emmy had gone far beyond his reach. She eloped with Mr. Doschel to St. Louis and married him. Emmy's action affected Otto deeply. Otto suspected Hedda knew of this from the very beginning, but due to the lack of proofs, he didn't blame her for it. Otto's desperation now made him spend all his money on Hedda. He increased her allowance to $125 and even took her to Germany for vacations. In an attempt to get over with Emmy's betrayal, Otto decided to propose Hedda for marriage. Hedda always declared her love for Otto, but knowing that his first wife is still alive and bedridden, she declined his offer of marrying him. Hedda was ready to be Otto's mistress throughout her life, but marrying him would have been a violation of her own ethics. At any cost, she didn't want to become the reason for Otto to abandon his first wife when she needed him the most. I would not leave Mrs. Kohler behind, sick and helpless as she was. I just gave myself away, because I loved him, said Hedda. Otto was an egoistic man who wasn't going to take this rejection casually. He was planning to take his revenge by taking other women out. Hedda hired a private detective to check on Otto and was told that he was going out with another woman. Otto was ignoring Hedda, who was completely relied on him for the luxurious lifestyle. The fear of Otto abandoning her wasn't allowing Hedda to live in peace. She knew it very well that without his financial support, she'll lose all the amenities she became used of. She contacted Otto and asked him to meet her once. Otto declined the offer at first but agreed after some consideration. Otto was finally ready to meet her, but he wouldn't show up at her cottage. Instead, he told Hedda to meet him in the red light area of San Antonio. Well, that wasn't all Otto asked for. He had a whole trap set for Hedda. Otto asked Hedda to bring all of her papers. Anything and everything that were proofs of her existence were required, be it love letters or bank receipts or IDs. Hedda understood that Otto's intentions weren't right. Also, the private investigator she hired warned her about Otto. Hedda was well aware of Otto's power, and the only person who could save her from all this was the one who called Hedda in the first place. Hedda came up with a plan to end all the fear once and for all. Right, she called Emmy to help her. She begged her to meet Otto once and convince him to let Hedda go. The truth was that Otto never lost hopes of Emmy's return, and Hedda was aware of this. Emmy had to agree to her friend's request, and while she was on her way from St. Louis. As soon as Emmy arrived, Hedda asked her to meet Otto in Pearl Brewery and convince him to visit them in the cottage. Otto was surprised to see Emmy there, and as Hedda expected, he couldn't reject Emmy's offer of meeting the ladies at their old place, i.e., the cottage. Otto arrived in his carriage at 532 Hunstock Street on November 12, 1914, before 5 p.m. At first, he met Emmy, who insisted that he should talk to Hedda, who was lying down in her bedroom. Wrapping up the discussion with Hedda so that he could spend the whole night with Emmy seemed like a wise suggestion to Otto. Whatever happened after this is a huge point of discussion till date, but the result was outrageous. At 5 past 5 o'clock, Mrs. Neil Campbell, a neighbor, heard loud noises. This was the sound of gunshots. As Mrs. Campbell ran outside, she noticed Emmy crying for help in the front yard. Mrs. Campbell rushed inside and called the police. By the time a police team reached on the spot, the main door of the cottage was surrounded by a huge crowd. As the team made their way inside the room, the sight was disturbing enough. Nobody could say what had really happened inside that house, but there are several theories about it. Emmy was missing from the spot and Otto was found dead. He died when 3 gunshots broke his neck. Police discovered a .25 caliber revolver, a .32 caliber automatic, and an open knife at the crime scene. Hedda had deep cuts on her wrists and she was lying unconscious. Apparently, both of the guns that were found in the cottage belonged to Hedda. Police took Hedda to the hospital as she had severe bruises on her neck which were to be treated immediately. Hedda too disappeared from the hospital after she was charged with Otto's murder. State Senator Carlos B. was her lawyer, who suggested that Hedda return to Germany to work as a nurse for wounded soldiers of the war. Hedda never left for Germany. In fact, she was living in New York City. It took her more than 3 years to build up the courage to stand in the court and speak for herself. In 1917, she was eventually ready to face the court and the rest of the world. Well, she had huge support to return to Texas. Hedda received the assistance from the former governor of Texas, T.M. Campbell, to stand in the trial. The prosecution assumed it will be easy to put Hedda behind the bars as they had a foolproof case, although that's not how the result was going to be. Florence Rabe, the only person who could have testified that Hedda had planned to kill Otto, disappeared on the first day of the trial. Apparently, she found it better to take off than to fight against a lady who was getting the support of an ex-governor. Although police did catch her and brought her for the trial, she never admitted anything she promised to do in the past. A banker named J.H. Frost claimed that Hedda tried to cash in $10,000 letters of credit which belonged to Otto. As expected, Hedda never agreed to the charge. Also, she had several of her own stories to tell from time to time. The first time she accepted that she shot Otto to protect the honor of my friend. Later on, she changed it to, he was like a wild bull. I thought he was going after my friend. Once she said Otto tried to choke her to death. Once she said he tried to kill her with the pistol. At last, it was revealed that both the guns belonged to Hedda. As per her, after killing Otto, she tried to cut shoot, but she was confused. I didn't know if I had a bullet in my brain. And then she tried to cut her own wrists. The all-male jury said Hedda was not found guilty of murder. she was freed from any jail term, and all the jury members congratulated her. A year after the whole incident, Hedda went to New Orleans with J.W. Turley, one of the jury members, and married him. A few years later, the couple moved in the same little cottage that was gifted to Hedda and Emmy by Otto. The first Emma, who was bedridden for decades, finally woke up after her husband's death. Not only did she miraculously stood from the bed, but also took charge of the Pearl Brewing Company. By the time Hedda returned to stand the trial, Emma Kohler was able to turn her late husband's dream into reality. Pearl Brewing Company was the biggest brewery in Texas, and this is not all. Even after this, the strangest thing of all happened shortly after Otto was killed. During the Prohibition years, when all other breweries were shut down, Emma Kohler kept Pearl Brewery running. The company started to produce soft drinks and food products. At the time when women weren't allowed to vote, Emma was brewing beers. Emma Kohler took Pearl Brewing to the top, even throughout the Prohibition years, when they switched to soft drinks and food production. It was after the Volstead Act was revoked that the company grew faster than ever before. Hotel Emma still offers a drink named after the owner's three ladies, the Three Emmas. This drink is served with a warning: one is great, and three will kill you.